walking in the wasted city. Started thinking about entropy. Smelled the wind from the ruined river. Went home to watch TV. And it's worse when I try to remember. When I think about then and now, I'd rather see it on the news at 11. Sit back and watch it run straight down. Run straight down. I can see it with my eyes closed.
Yeah, all right. Let's get this shit on the roll. Ladies and gentlemen, 1212 Charlottesville, Virginia, all surrounding counties. I am the mouthpiece of the Southeast, the voice of the Ville, the man of the hour, your best friend, your boy boy, your wingman, the pilot to take you on a flight, the conductor to take you on a voyage, the guy to take you on a ride, the ringleader of this here circus. My name is V.A. Doe, y'all. And this is the Chris Newman Podcast, powered by Doe Man Network, I Feel Famous Studios, where all the magic happens. You're not getting no good music done in the city. You're not fucking with us. We got Money Hungry in the building. We got my mans, my co-host, my cohort, my best friend, and my fucking sidekick. I know he's going to be mad I said that, but fuck it, man. My dude, 700 Quells in the fucking building. Yo, what's up, G?
He my sidekick, y'all. Jordan, he Pippen.
Yeah.
It's your baby mama best friend.
Yeah.
Ejaculate and evacuate.
I love it. You got to do that every episode now. That's two episodes in a row. You got to do it every episode. We also have some special guests in the building, man. You know, it's just so dope that Chris Newman Podcast, we keep the doors open, man. We keep them here. We keep them open for the good people to help us shine some light on our city, to show you that it's so many different lights and so many different types of beautiful minded, talented individuals here, man. And I've got it's really dope to just have y'all here, man. First of all, let's shout out to my man Cullen, aka Fellow Man.
Fellow man. Indeed. Big fellow man in the place to be.
Yeah, man.
I like that ejaculate and evacuate.
Bruh.
Yeah. I say nuts and bolts, though.
Ugh. I like that. This is going to be full of content today. I can see it. Also, right beside him, we have your favorite host. And that's actually a fact because I'm a lot of people's favorite host. And this dude is literally my favorite host. None other than the maestro himself, my man, Remy St. Clair. What's happening, buddy?
Oh, I haven't heard favorite host in so long.
Yeah.
Am I still that?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm going to have to fight for that title again.
You might have to, yo. Seriously. Because honestly, I mean, as long as I'm on top tier,
see?
And you're my motherfucking maestro, you're my Mr. Miyagi of this shit. As long as I owe you, you'll never be broke, my
man. Oh, see, I love that. That's what it is. Thank you for having us, man.
Yes, man. Rugged Arts, man. Nine Pillars. These guys are innovators. These guys are, they make us feel the level of success that we work for every day, and they put their time and their effort and their own fucking money, should I say, to make this shit happen. They've done it year after year after year. Unfortunately, COVID, that's really all we're gonna go from with that. But these guys, they're artists, they're hosts, they're philanthropists. They put shit together, they break shit down. I'm really happy to have you guys here.
Thank you. Yes, thanks for having us.
Yeah, man. I felt a little reluctancy when you hollered at me to get on the show. Like, I felt like you didn't know how much love I had for you for this to not even be a fucking question.
Well, I appreciate that, man. Yeah. No, I mean, I am reluctant just because I'm reluctant in everything.
Right. That makes sense.
Yeah.
That
I'm just sense. A very self-doubt filled person.
That comes with being an artist.
Exactly.
Seriously. Yeah. If you're not that, then you're what? The baby?
Uh-huh.
Not everybody's the baby.
Just the crazy overconfidence.
You know, who knows what he goes through. But we got a 2-for-1 here. I didn't know I was getting the actual the kings of the nine pillars here. I didn't know I was getting a double dose. You were like, Remy's in the car. I'm like, holy shit.
Yeah.
Totally turned around where this fucking podcast episode was going, because it's a dynamic duo. See, what I was going to do,
you know,
do
we
is,
move as one.
Yeah, and that's dope. That's dope, because I was definitely going to interview y'all separately. Like, I was just going to... I know that it's only long before I'm interviewing, like, you know, the regulars of the city, and it's like, I'm going to run out of motherfuckers eventually, so I kind of wanted to split this up. But it's cool. We can do a twofer. It doesn't matter, man. We're going to get into some current events. We're going to talk about some shit that's going on in the streets. We're going to talk about some shit that's going on in the community, in the news. And then we're going to get into your projects and you guys' future endeavors. Is that a work for y'all?
Yeah.
Quells, does that fucking work for you? I'm sure you have a problem with something. Please.
We good, y'all. Hey, look, save the dolphins, y'all. I don't know what that means. Yeah, save the motherfucking dolphins.
It's just, yo, bruh, that's why you're here, bro. One-liners. You gotta have you a one-liner guy in the game. So, I want to do a big round of applause, man. Welcome home to Rowdy Rebel. Big shout-outs to Rowdy Rebel. He's home. He made it. You know what I mean? What was that, 7-year bid? 7-year bid. It's 7 years ago we was fucking doing the shmoney dance at the annex. That shit feels like fucking yesterday, dog.
Damn.
That's crazy, bro. Yeah,
almost a decade ago.
Yeah, yeah, almost, bro. And, you know, him coming home, he's came home to a lot of gifts. He's came home to a lot of fortunate situations. I believe Young Thug gave him like a diamond chain. I think he gave him two of them. Just as a fucking gift, like, yo, because he kept his word, because this is the result of staying solid, you know? This is the other side of the coin of the route Tekashi took, you know?
Hey, and look, Bobby Shmurda, he's still locked up, but he did some real admirable shit.
Yeah.
He was off for 5 years, and Rowdy Rebel was about to get 12, and they was like, the only way that he can get 7 is if you take 7.
Mm.
So he took 7, but... he was bullshitting while he was locked up, so he's still locked up. He got a little bit more time, but shit, that's some app. You feel me?
I think, you know, I don't ever want to push crime onto our youth. I don't want to feel like that's what I'm ever doing. Right. I don't feel like I ever want to advocate for that. I know doing radio, I will always shout out the dudes in the jails, and I will be given a hard time about that because it's like, are you rewarding people for breaking the law? And that's really not the case. These are the most misfortunate. You know what I'm saying? Right. When you can't live your life without somehow getting your black ass locked up. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, if I can't do this for them, who can I do it for? So I do want kids to take from this, be loyal to your friends, man, and know who to be loyal for. Because I've seen some people go down for motherfuckers that later on bit them in the ass.
Yeah.
Like, like on some real shit. Like, I've seen people catch bodies for people, and the person that they caught the body for is the number one fucking person that they, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's really hard to see that, to see somebody do that for the love, and then you are the person testifying, pointing at me in the courtroom. I did this for you, you piece of shit. You know what I'm saying? Right. So if I want to press anything to our younger viewers, which I'm sure most people aren't letting their kids watch this shit, but still, I want to...
The smart ones are.
Yeah, well, you see, that's why I fuck with you, man. I'm going to... Told my baby I won't go fuck with these buttons. These buttons going to get mashed on today, man. Niggas is going to be making a lot of points today. But, yeah, no, I do want to push, you know, the importance of loyalty. You do the crime, do the time. That's what it is. Yeah. You know,
and that's
what I'm
just basic principle shit, like in or out of jail.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying.
Yeah,
jail shouldn't exist anyway. But that's a topic.
Oh man, look, we only got like an hour and some change to do this goddamn podcast. All right,
just throw it out there. Like the thing that I was saying that was admirable about it was he took a sacrifice for the team.
Right,
I mean, it was a team play because he was the star player. This was Bobby Shmurda. You feel me? Niggas, they knew him more than they knew Rowdy.
Yeah,
you feel me? So it would have. You feel me? Anybody else would be like, "Oh, I only got 5 years. He only got 12. You good? Just take."
Yeah,
he was admirable enough to be like, "Yo, you feel me? We in this together. We're in this shit together." That right there. That's you feel me? Like that's character. That's you feel me?
Yeah,
he took accountability for everything.
Yeah, that's how you know they got it from the mud. That's how you know they got it from the mud together. Exactly. That's my brother. That's how you know.
He did some admirable shit.
That's real live loyalty. Side note. I learned today that was Rowdy Rebel on computers. didn't know who the fuck was rapping that shit. I just motherfucking just. I never questioned who the fuck made this banger of a song. Right. Neither did I ever look at it. I guess because I just took the annex for granted, and I felt like I'd hear this song once a fucking week anyway. Yeah. So it's like I never really looked it up. But yeah, man, shout out to 700 Quells. He stole that song. He doesn't do remixes. He steals people's shit and makes it hot. He does it. It's the 50 Cent theory I like to talk about. But
the refix, not the remix.
Yeah, definitely. How fortunate do you think, and how good of timing is this for New York and New York hip hop for Rowdy Rebel and Bobby Smurda to be out and back to making music right now?
I miss that up top flavor flair. Yeah. That hip hop once held.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Not disrespecting anything that's going on in the South.
Right.
Or, you know what I'm saying, out West, but
right.
That's the home. That's the birthplace. You know what I mean? So you want that to thrive. So
that's
the come up.
Yeah, and I mean just the industry in general is in such a weird place right now with COVID, like a little shake up, you know, something coming back around, a little unexpected. You know, because like he's coming back to a much different world than he left.
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah, it's a way different game than it was when he left, for real. And he watched so much unfold. If you think about it, Tekashi, when he first popped up on that porch with all those people wearing red, man, we just knew, oh man, this is something special. This is something new. Like I saw right through it. Because I'm like, yo, I never heard of this dude before today. This has to be a manufactured situation.
Yeah.
But I saw what it was doing to the world around me. I saw what it was doing to the people around me. It was a party starter. I knew something was up with this kid. Shit winds up going down. You know what I'm saying? Just kind of how everybody kind of saw it. Like, without even hating, like, these motherfuckers gonna get in trouble. Like, I can see this happening. And, you know, it happened. Then the rise and fall, unfortunately, of Pop Smoke. Young M.A. had her run.
Yeah.
That kind of fizzled out, unfortunately. Still a big fan of hers. You know, we do have 50 Foreign, who is a big star, mega star in New York right now. There's a lane open for these dudes right now. And there is still a relevant, this is not like when my son, you know, real hip hop is, this is not like when my son did a bid and came home and nobody relevant knew who the fuck my son was. Shout outs to my son, he still had cold bars, but for me to be a youngin from the Southeast that is rarely, like, I'm put on to different stuff. I didn't find out about Nas until, you know what I'm saying? His second fucking album, because I'm in Charlottesville. I'm kind of backed up. Like, there was no internet or anything. So it took a while for it to, you know, register. For him to come home, it's like he had no audience to talk to. The people he did have to talk to, literally dead or in jail. Like, or like got families now. They're not even street niggas no more, like, for real. You know what I'm saying? So Bobby and Rowdy, they are coming. I feel like they're coming home in a really good time for them. I think they need to focus on the music. I think, like, literally focus on them. You have fun, you know what I'm saying? In them years you can't get back. You know what I'm saying? And to be in the situation they in, this could be a big comeback for them, and as well as New York City. So I want to send a big shout out to them, man. speaking of the music business, Lil Wayne did some wild shit recently in the news. Now it's so crazy because, of course, I want to be a rapper when I grow up. Quells, how about you? Yeah, I feel like everybody in this motherfucker wants to be a rapper. I didn't know. I'm just recently hip to the whole Masters thing. I learned this from Jay-Z. Jay-Z taught me what I needed to know. The only blueprints I got was from this nigga. He don't know me, but, like, motherfucker, you raised the shit out of me. Like, you know what I'm saying? Just growing up, that fucking mentality of a youngin' hearing shit, doing shit, I just felt like, yo, what the fuck is going on here? Why is Wayne selling his Masters? Is this a situation where he's broke, he needs the money? Is this a situation, like, what's going on with you know, the next king of hip-hop here? What the fuck is going on? Like, we already see him deteriorating right before our eyes.
Right,
why is he's making decisions like these of just selling his own Masters? Is this a cry for help? What the fuck? I mean, what do y'all take on this?
I mean, I think, you know, I got a couple different takes on it. I think, like, what you said about us seeing him deteriorate is probably part of it. Like, I don't know how passionate dude is about making any more music.
Right.
You know, so there's a take where, like, this is him cashing in his chips, right? Like, he got all this at the roulette table. He won, you know, all these spins, and now he's getting out while he's ahead. You know what I'm saying? And, like, how old is he? Is this a Wayne, 40-something?
Nah, Wayne's like 38, 39.
Okay, so he's around 40.
Yeah. 40-ish.
I mean, like, walking away from the table at 40 with 100 million is, like, not a bad... That's not a bad way to go out.
It's not, but, like, that's his works. That's Young Money's works, though.
Yeah.
Like...
Entire catalog.
I think that, you know, that it should be a little more than just 100. Million. I think he took the short end of the stick.
I mean, his value to the culture is much more than its monetary value, for sure.
Right. Definitely.
Hey, man, I swear, that's what I was thinking about when I seen that he was selling Young Money's whole, you know, all that, like, a huge catalog. It include Drake and Nicki Minaj. I'm like, how do you split 100 grand between Lil Wayne, Drake, and Nicki? They not getting shit.
Yeah,
because they, them alone is worth more than that.
Yeah. So Drake alone is worth billions, bro. There's no way you can tell me Drake is not worth billions.
Like, it won't good.
I'm trying to. I'm still really confused about it because I'm like, one thing about Young Money, even though, you know, when it's crazy, man, because you could see Baby being the force of this, and you could also see Baby being in destruction of this. When I first saw Young Money come up, I thought this is the new fucking Justice League. I was a fan of everybody from Lil Chucky to Jay Mills, nigga. You could not, what? Bro, I was a big Jay Mills fan back then. This is fucking Making the Band days when this nigga was just walking around Harlem tearing niggas up. And I was a big fan of what they were doing. The projects I saw were the Young Money as a whole projects I really couldn't get into, but solo Gutta mixtapes, fire. Solo J Mills mixtapes, fire. Drake, get the fuck out of here. We're not even gonna talk about that. Nicki, get out of here. You know what I mean? But still, it was a lot of entities that I saw. It just wasn't put together clearly. That's the beauty of our age of hip hop, because you could tell that the RZA was very specific, know, about how I put these 9 motherfuckers in one room and managed to make classics. And it's not repetitious. It's not spread out. It's not all over the place. That's why this is really truly the golden age of hip hop that we grew up on. You know what I'm saying? Sure. And I see that more and more. So it just baffles me, man, because you would think they're way more close knit than this. It's especially Nicki, Drake, Wayne. I feel like they're having conversations that we don't know nothing about. You know what I mean? When Wayne really going through it, I'm imagining, like, yo, Drake, man, you know, this shit is crazy. You know, I feel like it took Drake to really be there for his brother, for him to get through his father fucking him over like that. It took Wayne's people to kind of be there. Khaled, Ross, like, it took these people to kind of be in his life because they saw what the shit was doing to him. His heart is broken, bro. You know what the craziest thing about Wayne was? That video he did where he did the transformations through the different Waynes. And I was like, God damn, when art imitates life, this is sad to watch. Because we're going through the reminiscence of Hot Boy Wayne, Lollipop Wayne, you know what I'm saying? A Millie Wayne, and then it goes to current Wayne, and you're like, fuck 2020, shit! Bring him back, yo! Yeah. Like, what did y'all do to him? What did this industry do to him? But we know what the fuck the industry did, man.
Same thing it did to Kanye and everybody else.
Same thing it does to him. And look at us wanting to be rappers. Fucking psychopaths.
I want
to
be a lawyer. I don't
know. Yo, for real though, we were talking to the younger viewers earlier. Younger viewers, those of you who want to be rappers when you grow up, this should be a lesson in the importance of owning your masters, though, for real.
Yes.
Because, like I said, if you take away all the extra shit, all the industry, this and that, all the personalities and stuff, 40 years old or not yet 40 years old, cashing out with 100 mil, like, you can't do that if you don't own your masters.
Right.
And your publishing.
That's facts.
You know? So, that's like, if y'all take away anything from this, take that.
Yeah, yeah, definitely, definitely. So, with all that said, I mean, there's so much fucking going on in the world. When they come out with these packs of COVID vaccine 100s, what y'all gonna do? Y'all gonna get straight or what? Like, I mean, how y'all feel about this? Because, I mean, me for one, I'm very desperate for the world to go back to itself.
Yeah.
But I also do not want this to be The Walking Dead.
Yeah.
And it's like,
I mean, I went through a lot of different feelings about it. I mean, when it first, because Trump was being reckless talking about how he made this thing happen himself and he's gonna get it out before Election Day, that, and the third.
Yeah.
It was like, you know, you can pour all the money you want at these pharmaceutical companies. You can't speed up the making of a vaccine.
Right.
But when you, like, read the news, it seems like they kind of did.
Right.
You know, because they developed this whole new way with the mRNA and, like, a whole new, it's like a plug-and-play, like, you know, vaccine type of shit, which is going to, like, revolutionize how they make vaccines in the future.
Uh-huh.
So, like, yeah, like, once I started reading the science, I was like, I mean, I'm as skeptical as anybody else.
Right, of course.
I don't trust the government at all. Right. But, like, you know, I do trust the science, and the science looks solid. So, yeah, I'll take it. I'm with you, man. I'm looking forward to getting back to normal. But it's going to have to take, you know, a plurality of us.
Yeah.
Remy's making a terrible face.
Yeah, I cannot wait for his answer to this.
Yeah.
Okay, now let's give him some more.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to let the world take it.
Right.
And then I'm going to wait.
Yeah. Well,
that's what's
I'm going
happen,
to wait.
Because you're not
going to
be first in line.
I'm going to be the first in my apartment and staying in my apartment. And I'm going to watch everybody else that get it and make sure that there's no side effects or anything like that. It just really feels rushed to me. Yeah. You
of
know
course.
What I'm saying?
Of and course.
I just can't do it. I'm a Dr. Sebi fan, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I got good news for you. It's a couple hundred million people that are going to take it before you take it anyway.
Right, right. Right.
So, yeah.
And right.
I'm gonna keep my eyes peeled, too, to watch all the side effects. Because a woman took it the other day. What was it? In New York.
Mm-hmm.
And 5 minutes after she took it, she blacked out.
Yeah, yeah. Philly, I think.
Yeah.
Oh, Philly. Yeah. Okay, so, nah, I'm good.
I'm so, please, Quels, I need
just,
to know where
yeah,
you stand
just
on this.
Throw this in there, like. I was just having this conversation because I heard somebody saying shit like, your kids might not be able to go into school if they don't get the vaccine type
right.
shit. So that
right.
shit, like, what the fuck? Do I kill my kid? Like,
what the
fuck? You feel me? It's like, because that's what you got
to
think about.
Yeah, I know.
Like,
honestly,
to
I get
my
it,
kid
bro.
To go to
do
school,
I,
do I have to fucking...
Do I murder my son
yeah,
just to get this out the way? Like,
shit.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
at the same time, I heard them say that it was a new strand of COVID. So how, like... The vaccine that they got, is that shit covering all COVID is supposed to pop up?
Because
if they get a new strand, what the fuck? You just going to keep getting shots every month, every single time one pop up? Like, that should eventually fuck you up getting too much.
Yeah, yeah, so yeah, yeah. I'm terrified. I'm terrified of my government. I'm terrified of our pharmaceutical companies. I'm terrified of all of this shit. So I don't trust none of you motherfuckers. I feel like I'm slowly dying to every day, any fucking way. What am I? I'm probably at a pack and a half of cigarettes because of the level of stress that I deal with on a regular basis. I got enough reasons to think I'm gonna drop dead. You see what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
There are so many reasons I feel like I'm not gonna make it through this week. Yeah. You know what I mean? I don't want some fucking shot to be another part of this. You know what I'm saying? But I don't know.
And they
man.
Say that there's going to be multiple shots. There are going to be multiple shots. After you get the first one, they give you a card with the date on when you got to take the second one.
Mm.
So
yeah, it's two doses.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, two doses. I mean, I respect that, Chris. It's like, I look at it like I don't eat meat, you know?
Right.
But like, mm-hmm. I fucking care what you eat.
Right. Right.
You know, I'm not going to I'm not going to run up on everybody talking about I'm right because of what I choose to put
meat
in my
body. Meat is murder.
And not.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah,
I'm
yeah.
I'm not one of those people.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's cool. I don't know. It's weird. I've had the flu before. Mm-hmm. And I've taken flu shots. That's happened. You know what I'm saying? I know people that haven't had the flu until they got their flu shot.
That's me.
You know what I'm saying? It's so fucking weird. So it's so many different reasons why I'm like, I don't know what to do. I just don't want to die. Yeah. How do I live?
And that's the other thing. That's the other thing that, like, the flu shot's only 60-some% effective, right?
Right.
And both of these COVID vaccines, the two that are out now, is like 90+, which is crazy. You know, I think it's because of the new science and the new way they're doing it, but like. Yeah, I mean, but also that, you know, 90% is not 100, you know, it's like if it's 5% of people take the vaccine and still get COVID, that's still like 15+ million people getting it.
And it's a lot of placebos just floating around too.
I'm so glad I brought y'all here for my show, because I feel like we don't have a lot of guests that would have numbers as to what. I think a lot of motherfuckers be like, man, fucking man, I take a shot. I don't give a fuck, man. I'm just cooked. So, like, having y'all here, this is very informative. Like, this, I think this is the first time me and Quels are just like, I don't know, nigga. They sound smart.
Yeah, like they got numbers, yo. I swear, that's what I try and use when they say numbers. I'm like, I'm in it. These niggas know what they talking about.
Are y'all free on Sundays? Y'all want to work on my podcast? I'm not paying anything, but God, do you get clout?
There you go. Why you think I'm here?
Yeah. I know that's right, man. I want to send a big shout out to my director, my videographer. This guy keeps me looking good. He does this really special filter, so my gums only look but so pink. Like, them joints, like, I seen it last episode. It was like, all right, my teeth look decent, bro. Like, you know what I'm saying? Because I'm smiling a lot, and he gives me good angles, man. That's how I know that this is a lot of love here. So I just want to shout this guy out, because my ADD has been kicking my ass between COVID and, like, unemployment and, like, fucking COVID and December. It's like, fucking what the fuck? Yeah, and unemployment. It's like, yo, I'm going through a lot. So my brain is like all over the fucking place. So, of course, me and these guys, we have conversations. We talk about, like, what we're going to talk about. And I really have some great ideas up here. Like, I really do. I don't say anything. I don't type anything. I don't make any lists. I just really have an anxiety attack, and I ignore these dudes' texts for like an hour and a half, and then I kind of reply. You see Quell's doing this? This is Quell's like, yeah, man, he's pretty fucked up, yo.
It's fucking facts. It's all facts.
There's some fucking air horns. But no, we were talking earlier. Dope man. For real, yo.
Dope man does make you look good, though. You see, y'all don't see the cameras, but he's shooting Chris at a high angle.
Yeah.
And what that does is make the gums look like 30% less tall.
Exactly. There's a fucking slope. You got to understand. He knows circumferences. Yeah. I wouldn't hire a motherfucker that doesn't know circumferences. I've worked with directors that aren't good with their circumferences, and let me just say, nah, 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 nah. Oh, God.
His numbers is good as a bitch. Yeah. So it's knocking off about 30%. Yeah. Y'all keep that in mind.
Keep
y'all
it in mind.
He got another 30 going on.
I know it's in 3D. But trust me, bro, I'm shot with a fucking HD camera, my nigga. Like, this is professionalism, man. Shout outs to Doe Man, yo.
Shout outs to Doe Man.
Big shout outs to him. But, wow. it's really dope that I had this guy, like, he's just able to, like, kind of pick up the pieces where I kind of, you know, fumble and shit. And that's why I'm glad that you guys are here, because I see you guys do the same things. I see y'all work with each other at a great rate. And I just want to say, just for anybody that isn't familiar with Rugged Arts, are y'all two a group? Is this just programming? Is this just, you know, like a situation where y'all are just, you know what I mean? How does this work, y'all's dynamic? Because when I see one without the other, I'm seriously concerned. I'm not going to lie, yo, especially at events.
Take this.
Yeah. So please help me out with this.
Yes, we are a unit.
Got it.
We move as one body.
Okay.
We recently, a few years back, gave ourselves a name.
Yeah.
Sons of Ichibe.
Sons of Ichibe.
Yeah, that's for all my anime heads.
Got you.
Right there. But yeah, we move as a unit, and Rugged Arts, we go back and forth with this one. He says 8 years. I say 9 years.
Yeah.
It's been almost a decade that we've been doing this, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And shout outs to Runt as well,
yeah,
you know, who was big in the birth of Rugged Arts. You
okay. Runt 215 and Ben Ford also.
Big okay. fact.
The OGs.
Okay. Yeah, because yeah, I want people to be able, you know, I want people to be able to see you guys and associate the greatness that I see when I see you guys.
Yeah.
Because I feel like this is a generation of giving flowers, but this is not a town of that. We really don't show enough respect and honor to people that have really put it all on the line to give us places to party, to give us places to perform, to give us places to just, you know, express ourselves. You two gentlemen have done that in a lot of different ways. From Remy, you know, basically throwing your radio job out the window because you wanted to advocate for local artists.
Yes.
That shit got you sent the fuck up out of there. And I was like, yo, that's when I knew that people, the gatekeepers are going to gatekeep. It just is what
big
it
facts.
Is, man. And it's a dog eat dog world. And I saw that happen. It's just so recently that I saw the radio was like, hey, submit for your song to be played. We're going to pick 3 out of the 3,000.
Yeah.
That's a beautiful, that's a beautiful thing, but it's like, damn, there's so many different ways to put things together for the city. As far as local artists, how you feel
Young,
about
Young, don't, I'm going to say that being on the radio is good.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not taking nothing away from
of
113 Jams. You know what I'm saying? It is what it is.
Uh-huh.
It's all business at the end of the day.
Yeah. That's a fact.
Please, people, don't compromise your artistry for anybody. Nobody.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not even your mother.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Nobody.
Because, I mean, personally, I feel like the radio station really put me in a predicament. Well, it put me in a position where I was able to shine my brightest. Mm-hmm. The problem with that was there was a ceiling, and I mm-hmm. didn't like the sound of that. I wanted to do more. I wanted to say more. I wanted to be a part of more. That's not really to take anything away from, because people have different strategies. Me personally, I feel like we can do this as one, as a unit, and if I just bring everybody and let the floodgates open. Some people feel
exactly.
like
yeah.
some people feel like gatekeeping is what keeps the lights on, and I'm not trying to knock that mm-hmm. per se, but I do want to say that doing this without the people, you're not going to get much support. People are going to support me only so far if all I'm doing is making an ass of every fucking person that I see. So I'm very picky about who the fuck I fuck with. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, so no, you have to be.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And I mean, like, you know, to go back a second about Remy leaving his prestigious, highly paid job on the radio.
Ooh, wait.
I mean, how could you walk away from that check?
lies.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
really took a bath on that one.
Yeah.
No, like, I mean, it's local. It's a local station.
Yeah.
The fucking, you know, the signal goes out when you get to about Target.
Right.
So like why are we not maximizing the potential of all the local talent we have here?
Exactly.
And it's like, you know, like submit this and submit that, and it's gonna go in front of the panel and we get reviewed and shit.
Yeah.
When we were doing the throne room, or I say we, I was a small part of it.
But part of it.
Yeah, when Remy was doing the throne room, it was like, all right, you're local, you got some music, is it FCC clean,
mm-hmm.
and is it like reasonably well produced? All right, we'll put you in rotation. Like that
right.
was it, because
right.
we deserve that. It's so few platforms for us out here. People
right.
deserve that shit. And the cream's gonna rise to the top. If you put that song on and nobody's fucking with it, nobody's fucking with it.
That's a fact.
Yeah.
That's a fact. I feel like the powers that be at 101.3, that rhymed, I should be a rapper. But what I'm saying is, my man Almighty probably taught me some of the dopest things about broadcasting. He taught me the dopest things about being an entity, branding myself. I learned a lot from this guy. I wanted other people to learn that too. That's what I wanted. And I think it was more of a, bro, nah, we keep the blueprint. Fuck that. We let them know than anybody else. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, in no way, shape, or form. Because I talk about the radio station all the time. I don't know if it's because I'm bitter I'm not on the radio anymore. I don't fucking know. I have issues. Maybe. I don't know. Fuck you. But my point is,
we don't get bitter because if we bitter, then they dead.
Yeah, that's facts. That's facts. But I do feel like, you know, anytime, you know, Big Homie, anybody from the radio station want to come up here. Fucking Klee in the morning. I love Klee. I would love to have Klee on the show. I would love to have Almighty on the show. I would love to have Be Easy on the show, because I want to hear from different aspects of, you know, the future of radio. Because let's be honest, internet's going to kill the radio star. You know what I'm saying? And we're doing podcasts. So, you know, big shout outs to us for thinking forward. That's a big fucking thing.
We don't have to watch our mouths. Yeah. That's my favorite part of this.
Say
shit.
Whatever the fuckity fuck fuck I want.
Fuck pussy ass cock shit.
Yeah. That's a fact. That's a fact.
Yeah.
So,
I'm going to answer your question from fuckity pussy ass cock shit.
Yeah. Fucking horns.
Put that on one of the buttons.
Yeah.
Hey, bro, no bullshit. If you a person who an engineer and you got to edit the motherfucking songs to go on the radio, dude.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a whole nother
hustle. Have you ever had to do one?
Yes.
Yeah? For your songs.
Shout out to the engineers.
Yeah. That's a lot of fucking work.
It's a whole lot of shit that goes with it. But at the same time, like, sometimes when you, like, I threw that out there because of what he said. When you're on a podcast, you can say what the fuck you want. So when you want to go on to that radio level and all that extra shit, a lot of shit that you... That might not even be a cuss word or anything. It still might not be approvable to them. So you still got to watch your artistry with some of the radio station shit that's going on now. It's right. It's like the radio stations now. I'm not saying that they don't understand the shit, but it's kind of like they scared to fuck with a lot to like broaden their horizons.
Right. Right.
You know, so it's like. It's like that's why radio, I feel like, it's going to get, you know, it's dying down and getting killed, because you can do everything on the internet and all these different ways, but the radio is too, you know, it's too restricted. Nobody wants to have to restrict their shit, you know, like their craft and everything. You know?
Right.
It's too much with the shit. You got to have this, have that. You got to try and beat everybody else. If they don't fuck with you, they might blackball you. It's too much coming with it.
Yeah.
You know, it's too much coming with it for somebody to downplay your craft.
Right.
Yeah. It's weird. Like, actually, when you really think about it, it's weird that terrestrial radio has lasted this long.
Really? That's a fact.
You know, it should have been done. It should have been, like, gone the way of, like, I don't know. Like, movie theaters, too. How the fuck have movie theaters lasted this long?
They're on their way out the window
now. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, as we speak, I think COVID made that decision for them. Yeah, but, for you sure. know, it was the traditional thing.
Mm-hmm.
Date night, you know, bag of popcorn. You know, you if you didn't overpay for it, did you even really go on a date? That kind of theory. Yeah. You know, that's going to be an old school state of mind pretty soon. It's pretty old school now if you think about it. But, yeah, shit gets modernized, man, and... That shit's forgotten about. I remember how big MySpace was, dog.
Yep.
That shit was huge. Mm-hmm. It was like
people
next level shit.
People were making songs about MySpace.
Yeah. Yeah. That shit was really, really big. Like your top eight, I own this picture, all that corny shit, dog. Yeah. That shit was something big. Tom. And then Facebook just came along and just like... remixed it, like, you know what I mean? like here's Deathstroke doing great, and then Marvel just comes out and makes Deadpool, and we're like, who the fuck? Hey, get this other guy the fuck out of here. You see? Yeah. See, that's my comic book nerds. Yeah, my friends know what I'm talking about. I was like, what?
Swear to God, I had no fucking clue. I said Deadpool, that's a Spider-Man looking nigga. I had no clue about nothing else. Nothing else. That's the only
Yeah. That is a beautiful thing, man. Yeah. That's the type of guest we got on here today, motherfucker. Yeah. Prepare to not know what we talking about when we get in the Lord of the Rings, bitch.
There we go.
You ain't going to know what the fuck. So, fellow man, have a project coming out.
I have an album coming out in 2 days.
Mm.
I don't know when people are going to hear this. December 22nd.
Oh, yeah. Way after that.
December 22nd. Yeah, it's out right now.
Right,
go,
yeah. Tell them where to get it.
Go to all my social media shit.
Yeah.
So I'm releasing it first on Bandcamp, just because I'm trying to get all the profit I can from it.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be on all your streaming services probably by the time you see this.
Yeah.
Death of the Author. It's 14. Well, actually 12 songs dedicated to 14 people. My musical influences, heroes that have died. All the way from Jimi Hendrix all the way up to Left Eye, fucking Sean Price, Prodigy. It's a couple rappers on there, but it's mostly not rappers just because, you know, I think making rap songs about
Rappers
is kind of like done.
Yeah.
You know, so like, I mean, obviously I could do the Pac song and the Biggie song.
Yeah,
and,
yeah, yeah.
You know, this and that. But I just thought it was more interesting to be like, you know, hopefully like one of the cool things about this is there's a lot of artists on there that most people haven't heard of.
Gotcha.
You know, for people like Phil Oakes, protest singer from the 60s and all this kind of shit. So I'm hoping that, like, I'm hoping I make some good music, but also I can introduce people to some music that they might vibe with.
Kind of educate.
Yeah, exactly. Like Double HP is a rapper from South Africa who rapped in Setswana. He's from Mafi King up there in northern South Africa, right near the Botswana border.
Gotcha.
And he died in 2018. He actually took his own life. And like we were saying before, like it's a world of not giving people their flowers.
Yeah.
Early and often enough.
Yeah.
You know. So like I'm hoping in my small way. I mean, dude was nice.
Yeah.
And I'm hoping in my small way I can like introduce some people to him. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I straight up bit his hook. Yeah. I just sampled his whole shit and just like replaced his raps with mine. But everything else is just the song he made. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
How would you describe your music style? Would you call this backpack era? Would you call this boom bap? What do you call your music? From what angle would you like to attack that?
I mean, it's weird, you know. I would say that I do hip hop.
Yeah.
I'm a lyricist, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I bar.
Mm-hmm.
But I bar different.
Okay.
I'm always gonna come at you from an angle that you haven't expected.
Yeah.
I mean, musically, I mean, you know, definitely, I grew up on backpack shit and boom bap shit.
Yeah.
For sure. It's a mixed bag musically. A lot of it doesn't really sound like rap until I start rapping. You're like, oh, okay.
That's my favorite kind.
Yeah.
Wow, this classical song sounds amazing, delightful. Wait a minute, is that a gentleman rapping? It's a hip hop song. This is wild. That's dope.
Yeah, exactly. Nah, I do a lot. I do a lot of different shit. I wouldn't say that I have a sound beyond just bars. Anything right. I do, I'm gonna bring you bars.
Yeah. That's dope.
Yeah. I got a question for both of y'all. So, and this is some way that I begin like a perspective about, you know, like people music off of their name. I gotta understand exactly everybody's name. And I heard the name that you said, y'all switch our name to Sons of Ichibe. All right, so boom, yeah. I know everybody, they're not gonna know.
Right.
You feel me? They like, oh shit. So I want to know what that's like, how y'all got each individual name, you feel me, where y'all names can, you feel me, where y'all got the whole generation from and everything, you feel me, what made you think of y'all names and what y'all, you feel me, pushing.
Before y'all answer that, that was a wonderful question. I just want to give them their flowers now.
Yeah, exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
So they got to understand.
Thank
it.
You.
That's how I feel, you feel
See?
Me? A motherfucker might not necessarily, like, a lot of people who don't fuck with people with music or all the extra shit is because half the time they don't understand the shit.
Right.
Once they start to understand it and they on the same page, it's like, oh shit. Like a lot of rappers that I listen to and all that extra shit, I look at their interviews. You feel me?
Yeah.
I gotta see who they are as a person, what's going on. And then it's like, oh, now you got a better understanding of what's going on in the song.
Bro, you are a great co-host. Dope Man, I told you we didn't need to fire him, yo. I told you he was doing great. Dope Man wanted to get rid of you. That's wild. So help us.
I gotta say, when it comes to names and labels and everything, I love answering questions like that. And I love answering this question.
Yeah.
The reason why we go by the mantle of Sons of Ichibe is because one of my favorite mangas, and I read mangas. If y'all don't know what a manga is, that's a Japanese comic. All right. So I watched, I read this joint called Bleach. And in Bleach, it's a character named Ichibe. And Ichibe is the guardian of the god, of the god, and he's the giver and taker of names.
Okay.
So I felt as though we label ourselves as gatekeepers of hip hop in this community.
Okay.
So giver and taker of names, you know, with right wordplay, we can take a name, we can give a name, you know, Nine Pillars going down, we giving out trophies and everything like that, showing respect to everyone, like you said, giving roses.
Yeah.
So we just felt as though that name really, really fit. You know what I mean? And plus, he carries a sword. And Newman, you know I love a sword. So.
You love swords, yo.
Yeah. So, yeah.
This nigga is swords. I'll never
that's
get it, but he loves swords.
Name,
that's
bro.
A good
like, that's
a dope
why I had to ask, you feel me? Because like when you're an artist, bro, you know that it's something to everything.
Yeah.
You feel me? It's a reason why their name is that. It's, you feel me? It's always a story behind the shit. You got to Gotta get that shit figured out. You know what's crazy, bro? I had a shirt when I was up in high school, bro. When I was up in high school, shout out to fucking like Spencer's and all of that
shout
shit.
Shout out to Spencer's.
I used to steal the shit out of y'all shirts until I got caught in the mall, bro.
Oh, shit.
I had a shirt that had the Bleach shit on there. Never knew what it was. Like an anime joint,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I stole one of those shirts. Shout out to Bleach and Spencer's, man.
There you go.
we're the generation of wearing shit we know nothing about. This nigga had a Purple Rain shirt on yesterday. I'm sure he knows something about Prince because he's at least that black. But this nigga, yeah, we're that generation.
You talking about this one?
Holy shit, that's the exact same shirt.
Yeah, there you go.
It's the exact same shirt.
Shout out to Spencer's for their inventory control of failings.
Yeah.
Bro, and look, if y'all go back, what episode was that?
That was last episode.
Six.
No, that was six. Yeah.
If y'all go back and look at episode six, it's the same fucking picture. Like, his shirt is made different. Same fucking picture. That's crazy. Nice shirt, dog. Back to back. Shout out to Prince, man.
Shout out to Prince. Rest in peace. I got a tribute to Prince on the album, too.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's
okay.
A little different, though. Man, it fucked me up when Prince died. I'm not even going to front.
Like, yeah.
And I know it's not cool to say.
Right.
But that's sort of what the whole album is about.
Okay.
Like, trying to, like, you know, figure out why. Like, I never met this dude.
Yeah.
I saw him in concert once, but like, he was never, you know what I'm saying? I'm not related to him.
Yeah.
He never wrote me a letter.
Yeah. Right.
But like, he kind of did with all the songs, you know?
Yeah.
And it was a conversation I had with my sister, actually the one I was talking to right before the mics heated up.
Yeah. Nice.
After Prince died, and I was shook, and she was trying to figure out why. And that's kind of where the whole album came from.
Yeah.
Like, because, like, I think as artists, as rappers, as musicians, we understand that, like, the communal feeling that you have being a fan of somebody and, like, how it sometimes feels like they're talking to you through the music.
Of course.
Like, people who aren't that inclined towards music, who don't have that, like, deep a feeling for it, don't really get that. So I was kind of trying to explain that a little bit with the album. I hope that comes across. And it will now because I just told you.
Yeah, because so you just gave us a whole blueprint. If you'd have left me to figure it out on my own, no, I would not get it. I wouldn't know what the fuck. I'd be like, what happened? I got to listen to this again. Because I swear to God, there are so many Kanye albums that I did not get first time I heard it. Fucking Dark Twisted Fantasy, I knew I liked it. I didn't know why. Yeezus. It took forever for me to accept Yeezus. Because I was like, yo, dog.
It took you forever to accept Yeezus into your life?
Yeah, it took a long time. Your soul. It took a long time. But now I am a true believer of Yeezus. Like, it's thought-provoking music. And we're not used to that anymore.
Right. Yeah.
We have to think of what your bars is trying to depict to us. Quells, he likes to make it look like he's a dumbass rapper.
Yeah.
This motherfucker really writes some next level shit sometimes. And I'm like, what the fuck was that bar about? And he'll explain it. I still have no idea what the fuck this thing is talking about. And I'm like, bro, how could you be that complex? And you're the same motherfucker that made a song about 40s. And it's the formal fucking T-Pain song, Shorty. Like, yeah, nigga, are you complexed or not? Are there levels and layers or not?
It's
nigga, which
always
one?
Levels.
Pick a side.
Yeah, always
it's
levels.
Always levels.
Always levels.
That's dope. That's dope.
We was talking about this, though. I was talking to somebody about this.
Uh-huh.
They was like, yo, what's one of your favorite songs? What's one of your favorite lyricists? Lupe Fiasco, Dumb It Down.
Yeah.
He is, you feel me? Like, bro, you said that, right?
Mm-hmm.
When we was talking about this shit, you was like, Dumb It Down, bro.
Yeah,
like,
Dumb It Down is probably one of my favorite Lupe tracks next to Hip Hop Save My Life and probably I Gotcha.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably my top three. Our argument was that he could fucking hold a candle next to Kendrick, which we both know he could not.
Whoa. Let that man talk.
I'm sorry. Excuse me? I'm listening. Whoa.
Well, we hold a candle to him how?
Lyrically, song-wise, album-wise.
Song-wise?
Yeah.
He can't.
Right.
Album-wise? Stop it.
The cool is the last.
Lyrically? Uh-huh. Stop it.
I don't know, man.
Stop it.
I don't know, man.
Stop it. Stop it.
I don't know, man.
Nah, Kendrick is a brilliant songwriter.
Mm-hmm.
That man knows how to put a song together.
Right.
He knows how to give you a concept and bring the shit across.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, it makes people, how great his song construction is makes people overestimate how good his bars are.
Yes.
Bar for bar, Lupe is nah, ain't no comparison.
You hit dinosaurs? Did you hit dinosaurs?
I stopped listening to that nigga after the cool. To be
honest, my gosh, man.
You know what's the problem, yo? The songs that they promoted, like Kick Push, it is like a complex song, but it's not. It's nowhere near his deepest shit.
So right, of course not.
Like, oh, that's as good as he can do whole time. Fuck no. When you go into his catalog and you hear, you like, oh man, this dude is.
I tried to listen to Lasers.
He got some crazy song, Daydreaming with fucking Jill Scott.
Remarkable song.
Yeah, it's
remarkable
way
song.
Farther than halfway.
He could not hold a candle next to Kendrick in a versus battle. I'm sorry. Sorry.
Hold on, a versus battle?
Yeah, he couldn't.
No, that's a whole different conversation.
Yeah,
though.
He couldn't. He couldn't. Because from ADHD to the Black Panther album, Kendrick Lamar has been batting 100.
Yeah,
I'm
versus,
sorry.
A versus battle. A versus battle, I think, really comes down to their impact on the culture. Mm-hmm. Whoever has more impact on the culture is going to win. And Kendrick has clearly had more impact on the culture.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Shouts K-Dot.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that's not to take anything away
on
from
a
him. Like,
level.
Check this out. Yeah. Nah, check this out. Right
on a mainstream level.
I'm gonna bring it back to a local level.
Okay.
I am Lupe.
Okay.
That's all I want to say.
That's it. That's the post.
I'm Lupe.
Yo, I was like, yo, this is about to get deep. He's Lupe.
Nah, that's it.
That's the post. I get it. I get it though. I get where you're coming from.
I am Lupe.
Right.
YC is K-Dot.
Got you.
I love YC.
Yeah.
He's not seeing my pen. He's also, 15 years younger than me, but that's whatever. I was like 10 years younger, whatever.
Experience,
well, that's beside the point. He's not seeing my pen, but that's okay because people, at the end of the day, people don't really care.
Right.
Like,
especially YC. He's good. He's like, I can see him at home drinking some tea, watching this, like,
He knows. YC, tell me. I know you're gonna watch this. YC, tell me after you see this.
Yeah.
You know, hit me up social media. Tell me if you disagree.
You have a diss track.
It's fine. I love you. I love you. That's nephew.
Yeah.
That's nephew.
I got you.
But he's not seeing my pen. But it doesn't matter because his cultural capital on this local level and now more than a local level because he's doing big things now is way beyond mine. Mm. And I'm cool being Lupe. Because I just want people to listen to my shit like they listen to Lupe shit. Like the over and over again, catching the intricacies, and the wordplay and the concepts and shit. And that's why I feel like right now is the perfect time to drop because people ain't got shit else to do. Mm. You know, ain't no club music being made right
that
now. If there is, you know, it's not going anywhere.
And Lou, I just got to say, you talking about making moves for the culture and your influence. Lupe is the reason why we have artists like Kendrick Lamar.
That is a fact.
You know what I'm
I
saying?
That.
And that's being real. When he came out with Kick Push, they were already giving him that mantle of the next Jay-Z, of that next MC.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like Touch the Sky was just the beginning for this guy.
Yeah.
You know what
that
I mean?
That is true. That is true. I just couldn't get through Lasers, man. I tried to listen to it. I couldn't get through it. It won't. And I'm like, bro, you too far ahead for you to be dropping projects. That ain't it.
But you know what it was? I guarantee you all of his core fans that was trying to keep up with his life as much as they could around that time, they probably thought it was a masterpiece. You feel me? They're always going with the time. That's why you got to understand everything. You feel me? That's going on with the person at home and type shit to see what they're making. Like, a lot of people not going to understand Kid Cudi until you understand, you feel me, his mind. Then you're like, oh, shit, his music is fucking genius.
I get it.
You know?
I get it.
I get it.
Sound
like bullshit, you don't.
This is what drives me crazy about some artists that are super talented, and I see that they're larger than life, really, in a lot of ways. They start fucking crying about their fans or lack thereof. And this resonates very well with the city of Charlottesville because there are artists in this city that I really, really do like and I really enjoy listening to. But there's only so many rants I can hear you talk about your lack of support. I think that you have a lack of support because there's something you ain't doing right. It's not us, it's you. I feel like because you are my peer and because you are black as well as me, I will be encouraging, but I'm not going to be your biggest fan just because we grew up together. Nigga, you give me something. I feel like, and y'all stop me if I'm wrong, A lot of times you will hear this this demographic of, oh, it's a popularity contest. Oh, people are really only behind people that are popular. And I'm like, yeah, isn't that the fucking point? I don't really think that Jay-Z could have presented as Beanie Siegel if he wasn't fucking popular. Mm-hmm. I don't think that Dr. Dre could have given us Eminem, Snoop Dogg, 50 Cent, which probably would have done it without it. But you get where I'm going here. Yeah. Popularity is what keeps us involved. You are supposed to be the most popular in order to have the most support, because that means that your product, your brand, everything you stand behind is dope as fuck, and that's why you have the support you have.
Yeah, and I'm gonna go one level deeper mm-hmm. on that conversation. Okay. And this is Mr. Nine Pillars talking, right?
Okay.
I know everybody.
Right.
I see nothing but love for the people, like, you know, I feel like the people who are playing up this, oh, crabs in a barrel, this and that,
uh-huh.
Like nobody shows support. You got to be popping, like you got to be on before people support you. I don't see that around me.
Mm.
You know, V.A. Doe,
yeah.
Remy St. Clair,
yeah.
Stephon Marsh,
yeah,
fucking Easy Loc, whoever,
yeah,
all of the people who have made moves. I see, like, when I get together with them, when we see each other, when we're in a room together, it's nothing but love.
Mutual respect.
Mutual respect, yeah. And the people who, you know, like I was talking about Wasi earlier, you know, young kids, Keese, mm-hmm. rest in peace, Danny Ells.
Yeah, right, rest in peace, Danny Ells. Rest in peace.
Like, I feel like it's never been anything but love between all of those people, but... like the second somebody comes out of their mouth with, I don't get the support I deserve. That's mm-hmm. when they stop getting that support. Like,
yeah.
That's when that love stops. It's
yeah.
The, you know,
you speak life into it.
Yeah, exactly.
Here is their biggest plight. And I want to say this because I know for a fact with numbers and just walking through a fucking random Reed's parking lot, I am the most popular rapper in this motherfucking city. Okay, Quills, take a second. Let me pod fucking cast here. You have your time to rebuttal. I promise you, you'll have your time to say what you got to say.
Shout out to Lons.
Yeah, well, of course we have a whole new generation yeah, of this. You know what I'm saying? Lons is covering a lot of ground right now. I only stretched out to Stanton because of the stories of me. I never went there and physically laid my... Lons physically goes to Stanton and lets everybody know who the fuck he is. Oh, fuck. You ask a 19-year-old who V.A. Doe is, it's going to be a sketchy subject. I get it. My point that I'm making is... I almost forgot my point. But no, the point...
yo, no bullshit. I was in... Right. I'm as you said we were going to talk about, I'm a high school teacher.
Yeah.
And a kid dropped off the Zoom one time, and he came back, and he said, "I'm back. I got the city on the map."
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, of course. I was like, I'm That's Lons. When you knew. That's and he when said, knew. "He said, wait, you know who that is?"
Who doesn't the fuck know who Lons is?
Who the fuck doesn't know who Lons is?
Like, yeah. I think I heard an old man, like, almost get hit by a car. And he was like, "I'm Lons. Yeah. Bitch ass nigga." So, yes. That's a bit. But see, Lons is a perfect example of it. Because the moment that Lons would... And he never would do this because he's just the most positive nigga I've ever met in my whole entire life. And that's why I think he gets the response that he gets. Mm-hmm. There's no frills here. There's no ultimatum. He's just him. He's not even here to say that he's the greatest rapper in the world. He's here to give you a good time, because when's the last time you had a good time? That's where the popularity comes in. Mm-hmm. That's where the support comes in. Right. All of this shit goes in hand in hand. It's just what the fuck it is. The problem is the moment that me, V.A. Doe, I begin to speak about how much I'm not getting support, that's when the people that do support me are looking at me crazy. Yep. They're like, hold up.
Exactly.
Hold up. The fuck I've been doing all this time? Yeah. Mm-hmm. For me to get out here and be like, oh, y'all don't support my podcast. Y'all don't fuck with Chris Newman podcast. I'm doing this for y'all. See, y'all some fucking haters. I don't need none of this shit. I can't wait to go back to fucking Atlanta or whatever. Blah, 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 blah. That's when the people that are behind me, the people that are supporting me, are starting to feel like, well, why the fuck am I here? Who the fuck am I, chopped liver? Am I not the motherfucker that you wanted to support you? I'm sorry. And I feel like that's when you lost a fan with me. to be honest. And there's some rappers in this town that I really, really fucked with on a lot of levels. Niggas that deleted me from Facebook because I'm not sharing their shit. I'm not going to share your shit, bro. I don't, for real, I don't like it. To be honest, if I like the shit, I probably fucking share it. I don't like what I see here. And every LT video that I see, I'm like, I like this.
Yep.
Share. And you know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, this is what it is.
Yeah, and I can say with pride that I have never done that fake bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
If I have told you, anybody who's watching or listening right now, if I have ever told you that I fuck with your music, it's because I fuck with
your music. Yeah.
I don't do that shit. I don't do that like you get off stage, oh, dope set, bro. That was awesome.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, in the meantime, I'm like, you know, like, talking shit about you in the back, like by the bar.
Yeah, get him the fuck out of here.
Yeah, why, like, what's the point of doing that?
Yeah.
And at the same time, I forgot what I was gonna say.
Nah, you're doing great, man. We're on a fucking roll, man.
Hey, I don't want that coming over here to me. Started over there, now it's coming to
home.
To put up a wall.
No, you didn't have this asshole jump in the middle of him, though. He has no excuse. This motherfucker triggers me. I told y'all about this while we was outside smoking.
I'm gonna tell y'all what my specialty is, dog. Noomi could be talking about something. I'll have a perfect fucking point about the shit. I'll get my point off and keep talking, and we defer from whatever the fuck Noomi was talking about. And that was up to him to remember that shit. If he don't, we all fuck. New subject. Yeah. That's what it is.
Oh, I remember what I was gonna say now.
Great.
Artists.
Yeah.
You're allowed to be disappointed with the reception to your work.
Mm-hmm.
That is totally allowed. We all have that. Like we were saying at the start, I'm a self-doubt filled motherfucker.
Right.
Like you are allowed to be, you know, to feel like privately that you don't get the support you deserve. But keep that shit private.
Yeah.
You know,
and let that drive you instead of hinder you.
Exactly.
That's the thing. You have to do that.
Yeah, you have to give support in order to receive it.
Yeah.
Like you were talking about Lons. Lons is that everybody's everything.
Everything.
And he know everybody in the function, you know what I'm saying? And he making his way through, like, that's why he gets what he's getting.
This nigga was at my niece's birthday party. I'm like, how the fuck you know my niece? He said, I'm Lons. Hey, and went and got some punch and cake.
And I swear, that's back. Getting back to what I was saying, yo, you got to know these people personally. If you know them people personally, that's why so many people fuck with Lons' music and won't support y'all shit or whatever, because y'all, the whole time they see y'all sharing y'all shit, when y'all not sharing y'all shit, y'all making a post about fuck y'all because y'all don't share my shit.
Right.
You're angry motherfuckers. So they just like, well, I'm going to just fall back. You feel me? Lons is just sharing his shit. You feel me? Like,
I don't give a fuck.
We lit. I'm Lons. I'm here. If you don't fuck with me, I'm still Lons. I'm still lit. Join me if you want to join me. If you don't, I'm going to stay out. You feel me? Whatever. Don't
I could
me.
Sit down with him and be like, hey, so Lons, I really don't like your music. He would be like, I'm Lons, and walk the fuck away. There was no emotion, nothing. Like, he had skates on, just rolled away. I'm Lons.
I wanna thank everybody for tuning in to the Lons Appreciation Podcast.
Hey, word, bro.
We talk more about Lons than me.
That's a fact.
Yes,
that's a fact.
That's a fact. My bad, bro.
Look, nah.
Shout out the Lons, but hey, Lons, you out of this, bro. But look, you had a good point over here.
Yeah,
we got you all.
But nah, I'm just playing.
Prospect shit, man. Nah, we look out for each other. So more about you. How did Nine Pillars come to play?
He never gave the name though.
Oh,
like
your fellow man, yeah.
I need the individual names.
I went through some dumb motherfucking rap names. I'm not even going to tell you my first two or three
rap
names.
Come on. Give us one or two or three. Come on.
CM Dyslexic.
What? Now I wish I didn't ask. I knew it was going to be something I wish I didn't ask.
Yeah.
What is CM?
I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
Wow.
I think that I settled. So I loved one of my biggest influences is Method Man.
Okay.
Not necessarily subject matter, obviously, because the weed raps are far, far in the rearview mirror for me.
Yeah.
But in terms of flow, like that dude just had a godly flow, and I would study his flows.
Same.
He's not even my top three Wu members, but he's still like, in terms of flow, there's nobody, you know, who's ever done what he did.
Yeah.
So, and of course you had Method Man and you had Red Man, and that was back when Beanie Man was big.
Yeah.
And I listened to a lot of dance hall, so it was also like Yellow Man, and I was like, man, I need something with a man on it.
Yeah. Okay.
And I started thinking, like, you know, so what do I represent? And, you know, we are, you know, I do a lot of braggadocious. I'm the best. I just like basically challenge YC, but yeah. I do a lot of that shit, really? But that's not really like at right. the end of the day, I'm all about the unity in this yeah. music shit and yeah. just of humanity in general.
Yeah.
So I was just like, I'm just your fellow man.
Okay. That's dope though.
Yeah.
That works, man. And you get very boisterous, yo. You show us that look, man. I'm humble. I'm a humble guy. Like, let me give you a disclaimer before I start rapping, okay? I'm very humble, okay? None of you fucking MCs could ever come close. I give a fuck, nigga. I love it, yo. It's a beautiful thing.
And your opinion, what's your top two lyrical songs that you have?
Oh, of my songs?
Yeah.
So, the first track on The Death of the Author, which is out by the time you're hearing this, is called yeah. Sunset.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the songs where I just bar, I think I save all the cleverest shit and all the hardest hitting shit for that. So yeah, Sunset, and Remy, why don't you pick another one?
It's a two question.
The joints you did off the Bobby Smurder.
Yeah, 29.
Yeah, I love that.
What you spit the, to the hot nigga?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. You did? I think I heard that actually.
Did, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And
okay.
then I wanted to, you feel me, just so y'all can understand when he's saying he's how nice he is, I want to hear one of your, you feel me, like a bar and explain a bar, you feel me, so people can understand. Because a whole lot of people, they hear the music, the bar that you don't think motherfuckers is going to understand, uh-huh. explain it so they can understand how complex your shit is, so they can, you know.
I will gladly answer that question, but I need a minute to think about it.
That's cool.
Ask Remy something.
Yeah.
What y'all gonna ask Remy?
No, this is cool, man. It's all good, man. You let a nigga ask one question and then they just fucking lose their mind. These motherfuckers become fucking Geraldo Rivera and shit. Like, oh,
got
God.
Got some good questions, though, man.
I know.
Coming from the gut, you know, from what? The diaphragm, if
Between
you will.
Between this motherfucker writing down our topics today and this motherfucker asking good questions, what are y'all trying to do, yo? Is it me that we're trying to get rid of? Because you can't call it Chris Newman Podcast anymore. I'm not letting y'all take my name if I'm not on here. Yo.
Yes, sir. Yeah,
fuck you. Seriously, no.
But I gotta say, man, like, we had this conversation last night coming from the studio. He is really humble about his craft.
Yeah.
And I want to see that lion, that aggressive side a little more. You know what I'm saying? Standing yeah. well within his power. He's respected out here. Just like you said, you know what I'm saying? You respect his game. The real ones respect his game because right. the real recognize real. That's not a false statement. That's an absolute right. true statement. You know what I mean?
Right.
So a real lyricist appreciates a real lyricist. So I was telling him that it's really, really refreshing uh-huh. in today's time where you don't get a lot of MCs that are really lyrical and think about the content that's going into their music
yeah.
to get that song after song after song. And it's very thought provoking.
Yeah.
Not something you just hear one time, but you got to hear it over and over again just to catch every bar.
Gotcha.
You know what I'm saying? And yeah. stuff like that. That's what he gives. So.
Yeah. That's very priceless.
That's why I was asking that question.
Yeah. That's very priceless.
Some people go so far over your head. Uh-huh. They're not even going.
Yeah.
Yeah. See, that was my third round against Rel. That was the problem.
Okay. I wanted. You know what? I was gonna get into Whoa, that. I was holding on. I was holding boy. On to that. Uh-huh. I wanted to get to that because I need you to know I'm from Dice Street.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And this
that,
is not an
this.
Ambush or anything.
I know.
But
this.
I'm definitely from Dice Street, and you know how we are about our own. You know what I'm this. Saying? So at first, I wanted to be like, "How was it battling Rel? And how did you feel about totally robbing my man's?" But then I was like, "I don't know if that's how I really want to come off with this question, but you brought it up."
Dice,
so,
yo, Dice was so angry at me that night. The whole Dice Street, I thought they were gonna. I just told Newman where I live. That's probably a bad idea.
Yeah, yeah, because they are. So one thing about us, two things about us: we love to yell during battles when we shouldn't, and secondly, we love not letting shit go. That's yeah. like the Dice Street way.
All right, here's the situation.
Okay.
I figured out what bar I want to explain, so I can do that, or I can go into the go into the rel battle and give y'all the whole.
I think you can do both. I think you can do both.
All right, so the bar I want to explain is a bar that I want to take this opportunity to do so because it's in Spanish, mm-hmm. and I do a little this and that in Spanish too.
Okay,
and it's one of the best bars I've ever written because mm-hmm. It is Charlottesville specific bilingual wordplay.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to be from Charlottesville and speak English and speak Spanish to understand it. So it's very small, you know, percentage of my listenership that's actually going to get it. So I want to put it out there. Si vecino no sea vecino, sino asesino, acá las uvas pisan a la gente para hacer vino. If a neighbor is not a neighbor, but instead a murderer, here the grapes stomp on the people to make the wine. But uva is UVA, it means grape in Spanish, but also talking about UVA people. So here there are neighbors, but they're not really our neighbors. Instead there are murderers, and here they step on the instead of the people stepping on the grapes or the uvas or the grapes step on the people.
Nigga, you just blew my motherfucking mind.
This is fucking Virginia, bro. You know how crazy it gotta be to talk about fucking wine and UVA and the same thing? That's my whole point. This nigga said UVA in fucking Spanish talking about grapes in Virginia.
That's what I'm saying.
I think you just gained yourself a fan today, fellow man.
Yeah, fuck Trump winery.
Yeah.
All these.
That's his type of knock. That's how he raps, yo. Like, there are fucking. It's like a dream within a dream within a dream with his joints, yo.
Everything ain't for everybody.
That's facts.
You put the shit out there, the motherfuckers who supposed to get chills on their arms is gonna get chills on their arms. If you don't get it, you don't understand.
I'm just saying, don't remix Candy Girl by New Edition, my nigga. Like. Selling crack, selling crack. Like that's his music he makes. Like, pick a side, motherfucker. Is all I'm saying.
Do it all. Do it all. Yo, I'm the only person in here that's not gonna get superpowers tomorrow. So I need to be y'all's cheerleader.
I don't know, dog. You're tiptoeing on the scale, man. You're definitely I think you're sidekick worthy, dog. At least you've been an ally to our fight. This entire time, and I must say, you've never played yourself. You've never, risked your integrity. You've always been yourself, and you may be the only person that I know that is Caucasian and loves black culture, loves black people the way you do, and it's not forced. It's not like you're going out of your way to show us that we can think you're cool. Hey man, I'm not a narc. Like, you don't give us that. It's like, honestly, it's like, yeah, no, honestly, outside of you, you know what? It's crazy because that was supposed to have been our first Caucasian guest, but you broke that mold. Oh, so shout outs to you.
Is he still around? I would have loved to see that interview.
He lives in my same apartment complex. I see him all the time.
Oh, okay. All right.
I probably won't gonna be a here for that.
You won't go be here for that?
Probably.
Is it because
it'll be safe to be out the room?
Yeah, I'm not gonna pop up there, I guess.
So. All right. Well, that's one guess.
I would. Nah.
Well, we know how to keep Quells the fuck out of here. Right. That's dope.
I mean, sure, though, shout out to him. Glad that dog.
All right.
Hey, yo, for real though. For real though. Thank you for saying that. Yeah. That really means a lot to me, and I'm not like. You know, I think the fact that it made me uncomfortable to hear you say that because I'm so not in it for that, like, validation.
Right.
I think that is proof that it's coming from the right place. So I appreciate that.
Because if it felt
I wish you hadn't said it, but I
appreciate it. Yeah, of course. Honestly, if it felt any different, I wouldn't have fucking said it. Mm-hmm. I'd have been like, this motherfucker, that's all he want to fucking hear anyway. You know what I mean? White friends I got that I just can't tell them they're invited to the cookout because they'll lose their fucking minds. They're like, for real? Oh man, gee golly gosh, Chris, I'll bring all the gray weed. Like, still bring the gray weed, but
just drop it off
in front, yo, because my cousins, man, the gangbangers, they'll stab you. I don't know what I mean, but I don't want to digress too far. I do want to talk about this Dice Street robbery. The heist of all heists. You have hosted so many battles in this city. You actually revived the battle scene. You have paved the way for a lot of artists to get fans, to get to the next level. And I've seen you put people in position of power through their talent. I rarely see that in this city. And I do want to commend you for that. I do feel like at that point, when you said that you were going to battle, I was like, why? Because I'm like, I won't have a fucking, I can't host a comedy standoff and I'm in the fucking, you know what I mean? That's just how I feel, because motherfuckers know this comedy shit, I do it. People know that this performance shit, mm-hmm. I do that. Mm-hmm. I couldn't host my own stage battle and then be a part of the stage. It just kind of felt like a little bit of conflict of interest.
I agree. Let's go all the way back to April 2018.
Let's go. Mm-hmm.
April, or was it? That was 2019, wasn't it? When did I battle 18. The Richmond dude? 18? Okay, let's go all the way back to April 2018. Okay. So, who was it? Young Groove was on the card to battle.
Rel. Yes.
And, not Rel. Like Random Richmond Kid. I don't even remember his name. Cornball.
Was it Snot?
Cornball Dusty. No, or it wasn't Sneeze.
Oh, okay.
Nah. No. It was like. I think his rap name is like Cornball Dusty or something.
Okay.
So it was this random Richmond dude. So Young Groove drops out at the last minute.
Right.
I said, well, that's fucked up. We need to find somebody else. And Stefan Marsh is the team captain for Charlottesville. He gets to pick the replacement for Young Groove.
Gotcha.
And he asked me to do it. I did not want to do it.
Right.
I did not want to do it for exactly the reason that you just said. Number one, battle rap is not my lane.
Right.
And number two, exactly. It feels like a conflict of interest if I'm running the event and also, you know, like the host got paid with checks that my name was signed on. The judges.
Yeah.
You know, more importantly. So like, I don't want to do it, but we were running out of time and I had to make a decision, either save the event or, you know, save my pride.
Gotcha.
So gotcha. I chose to save the event. Okay. I won that battle. And of course, the winner of that battle goes on to the next battle. The winner of that battle was me, and the next battle was Rel.
Okay.
So I never wanted to be in that situation.
Right.
There was controversy because Rel said, oh, you picked the judges and you picked judges because it's your event. You picked judges that were going to be friendly to you. Mm-hmm. I did not pick the judges.
Okay.
I don't think Remy, you can correct me. Remy and Raven picked the judges. I don't think I asked who the judges were. I was told who the judges were.
Okay. Yeah.
And technically it was Remy's event.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, so we didn't include him on any other decisions. We didn't talk to him about anything because it would be a conflict of interest.
Right.
See, how we do things in Nine Pillars, being that it's a Nine Pillars event, we delegate events off to certain people.
Okay.
The only thing that everybody is working on is the block party.
The block party.
So he had nothing to do with the actual battle except for him participating in the battle.
You know
what I'm saying? I told him I don't want to have anything to do. I don't want to give myself an unfair advantage because I take this shit seriously.
Yeah.
So the battle came around. I knew who the judges were because he told me, and I think that's part of the reason that people thought that there was some shenanigans going on, because I like mentioned the judges in my bars. I like, you know, talked about some of the judges and like said their names and shit. But I thought that was fair game because I assumed that Rel knew who the judges were too.
Right.
Because if they told me, they're going to tell him. Right. I'm not trying to throw you under the bus.
Right.
If he had asked, I'm sure you would have told him.
Yeah. Yeah.
So all that being said, I personally, you know, I respect you because you watched the battle and you really listened and you said, nah, I think Rel got robbed, which is perfectly fine. Like looking back on it, my first round was trash. I will agree. Well, no, it wasn't trash. It was play. It was me just having fun.
You was fucking around.
I was trying to do a concept and like see how if I could stretch this one like nautical scheme for the entire round.
Yeah.
My round two was a nuclear detonation.
Okay.
He fucked up his round two. He stumbled and forgot some of his words. So I won that fair and square. Round three, like, as far as I'm concerned, he won round one. I easily got round two. Round three is a toss up.
That's where I'm at with it.
It was no shenanigans. And anyone who thinks that he beat me, you're entitled to that opinion.
Right.
But the day before, I was like, because it was $100 was the prize, right? Something like that. Day before, I was like, you know what? I'm feeling pretty confident. Let me put another 100 up. And Rel was like, oh, yeah, sure. You know, we can do that, because he was feeling froggy, too.
Yeah.
And I never got my...
Never got your money. $100. Well, welcome to Dice Street, motherfucker.
Ran off on the plug twice. Is it recorded?
Yeah.
Like, I was about to say, all right, where can we look at it at?
It's on my YouTube channel, Immediate Heat. All one word. If you just search Immediate Heat, you'll find it. Fellow Man versus Versity Rel.
Versus Rel. Yeah. Dice Street Rel. Diamond Dice. I want to say this, man. The only thing I had a problem with was the fact that you were battling. That's it. The fact that once you started battling, I felt like this was a good matchup. I felt like this is going to be entertaining. I did notice when you dissed me. I just want you to know that.
I did not diss you.
It wasn't a diss, but as soon as you said VA, though.
I mentioned you.
The guys, my man, Alan, is like, oh, what the fuck did you say, VA, though? So that off top had me like, grr. But no, I want to say this, man. I've seen Rel work, and Rel is a beast.
Yes, sir.
He's a bad, bad man.
Yes, sir. He's a monster. Yes,
I feel like, honestly, Dice took a L because we showed the fuck off. We showed the fuck off. Now, I wasn't there. If I was there, I feel like the everything would have been different, because I feel like the chemistry would have been different. The atmosphere would have been different, because I would have been there to lead. My brother's like, hey, shut the fuck up so people can hear this man bars. They're drinking 40s on the block, bro. You gotta understand, we from the fucking hood. They getting lit.
Yeah.
Oh, let's go win this. Yeah. Do I need to practice? Fuck no. I'm the greatest ever. Let me get drunk. That's what I needed. So it was like, I did not see, and I talk to Rel all the time, man. And you know, I definitely wouldn't bring this up if me and him didn't have this conversation prior. But I did not see him at his best that game. I really didn't. You know, me being from Dice and that being my young boy, I have to publicly just call you out for cheating. And it's not because, and you, and see, we have enough mutual respect that you know that he doesn't believe that, but he has to say that. It's his guy, you know what I mean? So it's like that's fucking bullshit. I don't like it. Like, when the battle happened, I was like, well, my complaining didn't change anything, so what the fuck, let's do this. You know what I'm saying? So when I saw the battle, I was like, you know, Rel hit you with some shit. We're talking the Mona Lisa versus one of those abstract paintings. This is two different levels of this. And a lot of TRL joints, or whatever the fuck it is, IRL joints. URL joints. What is IRL? What is that?
In real life.
Okay. URL. Chris Moon podcast, ladies and gentlemen. But no, in the URL joints, I see these dudes matched up, and I can tell that his style complements his style. His style goes with his style. So I felt like it was an uneven matchup, because we're judging off different things. People, you got points because you said shit the way you say shit. You Lupe'd the whole shit. It was like, hold up, wait. 2 + 2 = 4. Fucking the remainder 6. Oh, holy shit, he just said something dope. You know what I'm saying? Where Rel is very more literal. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I scoop you up, hit you with a stupid truck. Now you're stuck. Like, you know what I'm saying?
That's an amazing Rel impression.
Yeah, no, trust me, bro. Wow. I know my shit. So, I did. I felt like it was an uneven matchup. Yeah. I felt like you versus Raven would have been something I would have rather sat and watched. I felt like, you know, we could have had Rel versus Sauce for all that. Well, no, Sauce was locked up, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was.
Thank God. I don't mean that, but Sauce was very off balance at that point, and he probably would have destroyed the whole setup. Like, Dice Street, I'll kill everybody in this motherfucker. I took my shirt off. It's too late for me to calm down.
I said some shit in that battle. I had a bar about him.
Yeah.
I said something about put that key on you and snuff that candle wick. Then like Snoop verse Tim, I'm a murder your dog on some buffalo wing shit. Put the bird to the sauce. And I was like,
bars. Hey, bro. This nigga's nice.
It's still sinking in, but I know that shit was hard. That's what I love about my man, fellow man. Up.
He got all the dice straight.
Yeah. Yeah.
But nah, like I had to That's think good. About that bar. I was like, do I really want to say this? And I was like, oh no, he's locked up. It's all right. He's not gonna be there.
Yeah. Because you would have had to battle him or fight him.
If
at
he
that
had been
point.
There in person, I wouldn't have said that. But yes. But I mean, I think I want to say this. I did not want to battle. I complain. How often in the lead up to that, how often did I complain to you, Remy, about the fucking position that y'all put me in and how I did not want to be on that card?
Right.
Like weekly?
The whole week of every 5 minutes and 30 seconds.
but like, and it's not my lane, but like, I'm a fucking competitive person. So if you put me in that position, of course I'm going to go hard.
Yeah.
Like, I can't not.
That's a beautiful thing.
I got a reputation.
And at that point in time, it was a city versus city battle. Yeah, yeah. So we needed somebody that was going to step up, because Richmond switched players that week as well.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because their main person that was supposed to be there dropped out. Mm. So we wanted to make sure that we won't go in there pussyfooting around. You know what I'm saying? So Steph decided that he wanted to go this route. So him being the captain, you know what I'm saying, didn't go against the grain.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I just want to clarify, I did not diss you. I bigged you up. I said, I was referring to the prize money. I said, this is the tax refund, and you don't deserve this VA dough like 101 jams.
I remember that. I do remember that.
So
niggas was like, yo, he dissed you, bro. I was like, no, he didn't. They was like, yes, he did. I was like, okay, we hate Cullen. All right, we all hate him. Okay, I'm sorry, y'all.
Thank you.
So, you know, you're doing community outreach. You're setting up battles. You're setting up shows. You're putting people in powerful positions. Not only are you doing these things, but you're also an educator. How the fuck are you doing all this?
Oh, man. I have so much free time. It's crazy. Teaching from home is easier. And I'm just going to say, like, I know people feel lots of different types of ways. People with kids are really angry at us.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to front. Like, I enjoy teaching from home. I enjoy not having to get I can get up an hour later than I normally would. I don't have to commute into work.
Yeah.
I hate the fact that the kids aren't getting the instruction that they need.
Right.
The same level of instruction that I can give them in person.
Right.
But, like, I know we're doing it for the right reason, because we're trying to keep everybody safe.
Uh-huh.
And, I fuck around with the kids, man. I teach audio production and video production, so we just make music and make movies and try to, like, maximize their creativity, you know? I'm not teaching them calculus
anymore. Yeah, I was about to say, all right, so you're not, like, doing, like, boring shit that... We're pissed off that we have to listen to you talk about it anyway. So
I'm doing the shit that motherfuckers don't use, because
right,
a lot of shit you don't
right
use.
Because I mean, with honestly I think that shit should be a fucking K-Tech fucking thing. You know what I'm saying? If we're teaching motherfuckers how to be barbers, let's teach motherfuckers how to be engineers. Let's get Dough Man in there and do a couple seminars. Exactly. You know what I'm saying? Like that actually, I feel like, would get people a lot further, I guess. I don't know, man. Yeah. Fuck, I don't even know what I'm doing in my life, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I mean, it's weird. It's weird why those, you know, they actually put me, they changed, well, not just me, the whole county. Shouts to Ivan Orr, Bernard Hankins.
Oh, big shout outs to Ivan Orr.
Legendary Ivan Orr.
Yeah, big shout outs to Ivan.
And Bernard, the people who teach what I teach at Albemarle High School, they did the same thing. They moved our classes over to the Fine Arts Department. Mm. So we were career technical education, like closer to what a K-Tech situation would be. But they moved us to Fine Arts, which I feel sort of two different ways about. I basically agree with you that it should be like, you know, like more of a K-Tech type situation.
Right.
But, I mean... It's nice that the county is acknowledging that what we do is fine art and it belongs with the orchestra and the chorus, like, you know, and the you know, painting and facts. Sculpture, that same level of talent and artistry.
Okay. Yeah, so. Yeah, that's dope, man. That's dope. So, no, go ahead.
Question. So is it strictly just involved with like school, or is it like a way to kids and you know, like, is it like volunteers, different programs and stuff the kids can do too also, or just strictly just through the school?
Nah, it's I'm a school teacher. Yes, I have a classroom and hours and classes and all that.
I'm saying like extracurricular, like the way that you teach, like the audio and, you know, what you do. Do you have like aside from school that the kids can like volunteer type stuff, or the way that they can reach in and do more with it?
Yeah, you know, I used to. The first year I had like rap and hip hop club and like extracurricular stuff. It was actually that first year. The first year I did Rap and Hip Hop Club, Wasi, the aforementioned Wasi, was part of my club. And thank you again. Yeah. Like, Kendrick would not exist without Lupe.
Yeah.
You're welcome, Charlottesville.
Yeah, doctor.
You are throwing jabs.
Yeah. Like. But you know what, though? It's like if a jab was to be thrown at me, I would want that. Because he's giving you your flowers, yet he's like keeping you on. That's how he. This is how me and him compliment each other. You know what I'm saying? Like, you have to kind of do that because, like, you can't give me too much fucking props. I'm going to get big-headed. I'm fucking big-headed already. You know what I'm saying? So, it's a beautiful thing to have that level. And, you know, I love YC so much, man. I want more from him. And I know that I annoy him more than, you know what I'm saying, inspire him more, so to speak. Like, he's like he would be a great guest because he has a lot of shit on the contrary to what I think and believe. And I think we give off more of that energy than, oh, you're doing this, you're telling me this, I should keep pushing. Like, I love to hear more music from him. So if this is the type of shit that gets him back in the studio, I'm all for it.
There you go.
Yeah.
Whatever. I love you, Malcolm.
Yeah, definitely, man. Definitely. He's definitely one of the best, man. I think you doing the things you do for the community, you teaching, I feel like you dropping music at the same time. This is a Renaissance man kind of era, you know what I'm saying? Where you see Doman that's doing all these many of things to make the stuff work. I feel like what you do does the same thing, from you know, just setting up little talent shows every once in a while to you know, actually doing like an award ceremony for people that have put in the work over these years, man. I probably one of my most fondest memories before COVID was doing y'all's Nine Pillars event, and the fact that, you know, y'all was showing love to me for all the work that I put in out here. Because it's like, so many times I feel like I gotta stand up on a fucking rock and be like, hey, I'm the reason a lot of you niggas rap. Give me some fucking credit here. Stop forgetting about me, you pieces of shit. Like,
that's the truth.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I mean? So the fact that y'all are like, hey, you're the reason a lot of these people are DJing. Hey, you're the reason this person does graffiti or is a b-boy or is a, you know, an engineer, a producer, a rapper. You should be awarded for this. And the fact that y'all do that and it all trickles down to you being an artist yourself, you getting up there on the stage, having to battle motherfuckers you don't want to battle, you getting up there and having to deal with sponsors you don't want to have to deal with, the politics of it, even with COVID taking us the fuck up out of here. You know what I'm saying? Remy, you being a host, you know what I'm saying? You being a promoter without even really being a promoter is just like more a supporter. Like, you know what I mean? This is the thin line between people really having a heart into this and not. You know what I'm saying? Instead of looking for a payday. So I just want to let y'all know, man, that the city is very thankful for you guys. I don't see us having the organization or the organization to put together a event for y'all to get trophies. So this may be the closest you ever gonna get to that. So hey, I just want to shout y'all out for, you know, for being able to set your pride aside, set your star power aside, because I see two stars sitting in front of me right now, and you guys put that shit aside and you show love to the people around you, and I think that's really big. So big shout outs to that.
Word. Yeah. I gotta do my corny shit real quick though.
Yeah, please.
Because we had a conversation outside about when you started to get into hosting.
Yeah.
Now,
I wanted to flip that on you because I do this every time we get together, Doc, but this is how much respect I have for you.
Yeah.
The Irish pub that used to be on Preston Avenue.
McGrady's.
Yeah.
All right? Before it was McGrady's.
Before McGrady's.
Yeah.
This was when it was the pool hall.
Yeah.
All right?
Yeah.
Now, I didn't know what the MRC was. Mm. I was in Buford School in the seventh grade. Mm. I went to a show. You were the first MC I saw on stage.
Yep. I remember that.
When that moment hit, I signed up for the MRC the next day.
Yep.
So when you meet individuals like that, you can't forget.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And they deserve everything, whether the world acknowledges them or not. What they did for you,
yeah,
that's what you need to let them know.
Yeah.
So once again, brother, thank you for inspiring me and showing me that it's not something that only these guys from New York or Philadelphia can do, these big wigs in the industry. You showed me that local is accessible.
Yeah.
So thank you for that. And once again, you're doing that with the podcast too. You know what I'm saying?
Shout out to me,
Trendsetter, right?
For being innovative, for giving you niggas a fucking lane. Shout out to this guy. Nah, I can dig it, man. Definitely.
Hey, look, and big ups to them, bro, because look, they putting on for all of the underground. You feel me? All of the people who feel like they don't have a voice or all of that extra. You feel me? These are the people that's your voice.
Yeah.
You feel me? Like, if they reaching out all the way down to kids, bro.
Yeah.
You feel me? Like, that's way down there. You feel me? For them to come around and bring a local, you feel me, like, smack DVD. You know how motherfuckers around here, they gravitate to that shit to actually have one. For the local people to make their own presence, you feel me? Another platform type shit, that shit huge.
Yeah.
You feel me? That's you feel me? They giving everybody their flowers.
Yeah, that's dope. That's dope. Word. I just want to say we at 135. That's a good time. Dope man goes through stages in his face where he's like, we're rolling, guys. So, all right, it's been a while, guys. So, when the fuck are you gonna shut up? Like,
yo, if If you want brevity, I don't think Chris Newman is the right person to be working with.
I don't even know what that means, but I feel like I know what the fuck that means.
This man likes to talk.
Yeah. Honestly, the sound of my own voice, man, I swear to God, heaven to me. Heaven to me.
Vocal, you know, lavender.
That's goals right there.
That's my white noise.
I hate the sound of my voice.
I love it.
That's definite goals. Oh, you love the sound of my voice?
No, of mine.
Oh, okay. I was about to say. I sound like a...
I mean, you don't sound too bad either, but the way I sound is...
Let me get another question from both of y'all. Who are y'all top five people that then came on and you feel me, partook in y'all events any year? You feel me? Top five from any year. Who are y'all top five that y'all had?
Y'all only local?
Yeah.
Okay.
Here we go. We're going to have a post about us in the morning.
It's perfectly fine. God, fuck it.
All right. Shaq Gill, I'm not going to make the same mistake you made.
Yeah.
Because we were talking about that earlier.
Yeah.
He dropped a list that had both me and Remy and you on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And people went
bananas. Nothing gets the city's dick hard quicker than a list of who someone thinks their top five rappers are. It's just how we are, bro. I don't know why. Every time.
And just to throw it out there, I wouldn't even ask him, man. If you did not give those bars, you feel me? Once you see a person craft as good as a bitch, it's like, oh, they, you know, that whatever they giving you is valid. You feel me? So you gotta respect niggas' opinion. Something, you feel me? If they that good, they know what good is.
Yeah.
Why thank you. Top five of Charlottesville from our events over the years. Mm. I mean, it's easy to just say, like, you know, the top five, like, you know, because we had V.A. Doe. We had Steph Marsh.
Mm-hmm.
We had Wasi and Keese and Danny Ells, again, rest in peace. Like, it's easy to say the heavy hitters, but I got to think of some people that I feel like y'all should be on the watch for.
Right.
Yeah. I was asking more so which ones you feel like did the best in that environment. You feel me? Just that specific.
Okay.
Taking y'all an event, who do y'all feel like was the heavy hitters, you feel me?
Yeah.
In that world, you feel me, that y'all bring it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, who presented the most?
Just be safe and be like, V.A.'s those the greatest entertainer and performer you've ever seen in your fucking life.
Whatever he say, if your name don't get mentioned, you need to go harder.
You want to start, Remy? Because I'm having trouble.
All right, flat out, I'm a person that's big on stage presence. Your energy on stage, your delivery, everything like that, your breath control. So if I'm looking at an MC, I'm looking at all of that.
LT has been doing his thing.
LT
gets me hype when he's on stage. I got to give a shout out to my uncle Black Lick, because he gives a lot of energy when he's on stage as well.
Black Liquid, that's straight out of Richmond, right?
Yes, sir.
That dude is something else. Yeah, let me tell you, I had him on the boombox with me one night. We freestyled till about 4 a.m.
That's how he do.
Love Black Lick. Yeah, big shout out to Black Liquid, man.
For sure, for sure. I got to say, V.A. Doe's Hall of Fame induction performance, I got to put that up there as
that
well.
That shit was crazy. That was a good time.
The Beatniks.
Oh, yeah.
Can't forget about the Beatniks. I can't forget about the Legends. And I think that's my five, right? Or is that four?
That was
I'm not counting.
Well, yeah, there's multiple Beatniks, so yeah.
Yeah.
They'll be one unit.
That's the group Mitch is in, right? What was the group Mitch was in? Illville definitely was some shit. When I saw Illville get up there and do their thing, I swear to God, it felt like a Tribe Called Quest reunion.
Yeah, yeah.
It's been a long time coming, and we still got it. We some old motherfuckers, but we still got it. Right. So they definitely are one of my top five. So big shout out.
Yeah, that was one of my.
Yeah, that's Damani.
No disrespect to either group, but I get those groups mixed up.
Yeah,
a lot.
Man, Illville was definitely one of my favorite.
Yeah.
Nine Pillars Block Party performances.
Yeah.
Man, the sun was shining. It was like it had rained the day. No, it snowed.
Yeah.
In April, it snowed the day before, and it snowed the day after. Yep. But on that day, it was beautiful, clear blue sky. It was brilliant.
Yeah.
And that was when we inducted Bump.
Bump Brown.
Yep.
Yeah. That was big.
That was
that was big.
That was a great. That was a great.
I gotta. That's my number five because the collaborations, the energy, the love that was coming on and off the stage.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
All right. I'm gonna throw a couple out there that I think people forget about.
Mm-hmm.
So Remy's big on stage presence. I'm big on bars.
Okay.
I feel like there's some people whose bars don't get recognized as much as they should. First of all, Sunday. Cool. Sunday is a monster, and his pen is different.
Okay.
Kevin, he hasn't been around much lately. He's been laying low, but he's going to come back out, I'm sure, with some shit.
Okay.
I can't forget about Mike Bizarro, who does not get discussed nearly enough. Dude is, like, crazy with the multi-syllables and the concepts. Like, they just keep coming. I want to say Othello Skunk. If you're watching, I haven't forgotten about you. We haven't communicated in a while, but that dude is low-key nasty with the pen.
Sheesh.
Oh, man, there was another one I just had in my head that I forgot about. I mean, obviously you got people like... I remember Lalo, who since has moved away. He was here for a minute, but Lalo Lloyd...
Yes, sir.
Yeah, he is. I'm just thinking back on performances at Rugged Arts or Nine Pillars that have like really impressed me.
Yeah.
Lalo is crazy nice, and of course the homie I just had in my head again and I lost it. Shit. I'll think of it. Talk about something else. I'll think of the one more name. Hey, yo, fellow man, Death of the Author.
Yeah.
Out now. Check it out on Bandcamp. Just search fellow man, one word.
Yeah.
Death of the Author. I got merch. I got coffin-shaped flash drives that I'm distributing the album on.
You're not fucking around.
Yeah, CDs coming out, candles and stickers. It's all on Bandcamp, and probably by the time you hear this, it'll be on your usual Spotify's and all that shit, too.
Okay. Yeah, man, this has been a really dope episode. I want to thank you guys for coming through. Big shout-outs to Remy. You know, I'm going to have more room for you up here. It's so much shit we could talk about. Shout-outs to fellow man. Congratulations on your project. And thank you, guys, for all you do for the community, man. Like, seriously. Like, without a shadow of a doubt. And it's so easy to forget because... we've been locked down this whole time. But I remember y'all was setting up for another Nine Pillars, and I want to shout y'all out about that. I do have to say that if Doman doesn't get a fucking award at some point in time, we're all going to have a fucking problem here. I'm sick of advocating for him. He doesn't know about this. Can you let him know how much I fight with you guys about getting Doman into the Hall of Fame?
The thing about Doman is...
That's real talk.
The thing about Doman is, what's the category? Like,
right. right, everything.
Every category he's eligible man. For. Yeah. So, like, we don't know where to put him.
Right. That is true. That is true.
And I want to give a shout out to somebody that we didn't get a chance to honor, and I really, 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 really feel fucking bad about it. Mm-hmm. And that's Fat God, Mank.
Manky. Oh, my God.
And yes, there will be a Nine Pillars in 2021.
Yeah.
And he will definitely be someone that we are going to be honoring.
That would be
without
big.
Without a shadow of a doubt, without a conversation.
That would be big. That would be big.
Hey, bro. He was one of the first people that I actually listened to in Charlottesville. Heard one of his songs and was like, yo, this nigga is that.
Yeah.
Like, it was not too many people where you actually heard him and was like, oh, shit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He
yeah.
was one of the, I was young as a bitch, bro. We was playing ball at the rec down at, on the downtown mall, bro. You feel me? I was about 13, 12 years old, bro.
Yeah.
He was making songs. I seen one of his videos. I can't recall what it was. It was a long time ago, yeah. but he is the, yeah, he definitely
Mankey's
like
most,
yeah.
definitely one, yeah. most definitely one yeah. of the greats. Word. Big shout outs to him. Rest in peace to him. Our condolences to his whole entire family. Word, it's very few times.
Aside, my bad. Yeah. Not to cut you off, but yeah. aside from that rap, that was a cool nigga, bro. Was
he was the coolest.
Dude, word.
He was the cool. Who the fuck was cooler than Mankey?
He was everybody brother.
Oh my God, man. Yeah. The world has a way of losing certain people that that provide an energy that you just are not gonna get from anywhere else. Like that energy died with that person. You know what I'm saying? Unfortunately, because it's like it's just it's people that get along with everybody because they fake as hell. Mankey's one of those people that get along with everybody because he may be the most friendliest person on this entire planet. And really, when he died, I got scared for the rest of us. Cause I'm like, if God took him,
yeah,
we're fucked.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's how I look at it. Like, you take him because you know it's about some be some bullshit on this earth. Yeah. And you just want you need him up there with you more than you need him down here with us. That's the I don't know. That's how I think anyway. I'm fucking weird. But anyway, man, rest in peace to my man, Mank. Big shout outs to Domain Network. Big shout outs to our future sponsors. We don't have that many yet, but I feel like we're on our way to getting at least three. Speaking into existence, yeah. definitely. Big shout outs to my friend and my co-host, 700 Quails. Thank you for not ruining this entire episode. I know how bad you wanted to, and I appreciate you for holding back. Thank you, Cullen. Thank you, fellow man. Thank you, Remy St. Clair. It's been motherfucking a good episode. Where we at? 7, 8? I don't fucking know. When we do 10, that's when I'll start counting again. But yeah, man. Yeah, episode 8. This is episode 8. It's your boy VA though. Chris Newman Podcast. Thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. Peace.
Peace.
Ejaculate and what? Evacuate. We're out of here.